It's spooky season. Spooky season means a lot of different things for different people. For some, it's about sweater weather. For others, it's about further abstracting the reality of what a pumpkin is. And for parents and news stations, it's about figuring out what people are going to be putting in your children's Halloween candy. But for me, it's about an adorable miniseries that came out in November of 2014 that I made a point of watching around Halloween every year since. That series is Over the Garden Wall. Over the Garden Wall tracks the story of brothers Wirt and Greg as they traverse through the unknown, which many online creators seem to plagiarizingly describe as a strange forest adrift in time. So I will do that as well. As we explore this vast, confusing world with older brother Wirt and younger brother Greg, we watch them learn and grow, and in the end, we learn something important ourselves. The series has been celebrated as a masterpiece of modern Americana, combining American and European folk traditions with modern storytelling devices in a truly unique approach. And knowing how well the music aids in that storytelling, the thought of letting October pass without making a video about it felt morally reprehensible. So here we are. Oh, and by the way, this isn't just like one of those cut and dried music theory videos where I'm like, oh, that's a four chord and 18th century Europeans used those. This video is very much concerned with the ontology and referentiality and how music aids in the storytelling, so I'm about to spoil the absolute crap out of this miniseries. If you haven't seen it yet, I recommend going to watch it on Amazon Prime or here on YouTube or wherever you go to illegally watch movies and you know, download computer viruses. Anyway, here we go. So as I said before, this story tracks the journey of melancholic everyman Wirt and his little brother, the chaotic good bundle of joy that is Greg. Before we dig into the series itself, I want to talk a little bit about series structure, because Over the Garden Wall bucks the trends of commercial animation in a couple of significant ways. In the television medium, there are typically two types of shows, serialized television and episodic television. And I swear, this is all leading to music. Serials are named for their numbered episodes, where watching them in order is important because the show follows long-form story arcs either over the course of a season or over the course of the entire series, where episodic television relies primarily on standalone episodes. While serial structure is most often seen in soap operas and other forms of live-action TV drama, episodic television, at least in its purest definition, is well-suited for animation, because the showrunners don't have to worry about a character's age forcing narrative change, and with their target demographic often being children or casual adult viewers, it's best to format a show to allow viewers to enter midway through a show's run without having to catch up in order to understand it. Oh, and I promise I'm getting to the music part. Perhaps the biggest advantage for networks to pick episodic writing is that they can ask their popular shows to produce more and more seasons, popping out episode after episode, even after all of its creative successes have been exhausted, and the show exists as a shadow of its former self, mostly as a joyless cash grab for the network. And I'm sure whatever I decided to put on in the background during all of this is purely a coincidence. But when creator Patrick McHale pitched Over the Garden Wall to executives at Cartoon Network, he insisted on it being produced as a mini-series with an overarching story and a clear ending. And it is because of this industry bias toward high-producing episodic shows that Cartoon Network's decision to produce Over the Garden Wall was surprising, even to McHale.
Music is almost here.
But one of the things that makes Over the Garden Wall so beautiful in my mind is its perfect blend of episodic style and long-form storytelling. While it takes a complete serial viewing to fully understand Wirt's and Greg's journey, and is therefore best viewed in its entirety from beginning to end, someone could still watch any of the first seven episodes and get a lot out of them as self-contained short stories. What's more is, given the nature of the unknown, you know, how,
all of its inhabitants are likely people from different cultures and generations who died and are now resolving problems from their early lives before passing to the afterlife in a Dante's Inferno-esque purgatory.
Each episode takes on a distinct cultural or generational theme that can be hard to combine into a serial story structure while maintaining an immersive level of continuity. In other words, if you're going to go from a colonial-era New England tavern to a Victorian-era mansion in Europe to a southern Mississippi riverboat in successive episodes, you're going to need some pristine unifying elements. Over the Garden Wall excels on this front, with subtle title screen changes, tableaus reflecting the changes in weather, frequent callbacks to previous themes and references, believable motivations for Wirt and Greg at each stop of their journey, and of course, the music. Most theatrical mediums, be they TV, movies, live theater, video games, etc. Just a game. I don't think so! Contain two types of music. Diegetic music and incidental music. Incidental music describes the music that the audience can hear, but that doesn't exist within the world of the show. This music serves to draw attention, influence emotion, and provide information to the viewer while the characters in the show go about the action of the plot. Diegetic music does exist in the world of the show, whether it's performed or imagined by a character, or is played from a prop like a tape player or a Victrola. In Over the Garden Wall, the diegetic music is all over the place as far as genre is concerned. We're talking Fossa Law singing in Pottsfield, early musical theater at the schoolhouse, Tin Pan Alley song in the Dark Lantern Tavern, New Orleans Riverboat Jazz in Frogleg, Golden Age musical theater, Ragtime, British glam rock. This clip is just here for Phil. Latin chant. But they all fit together thanks to their interactions with the incidental music and with their relationship with the narrative structure, which is teeming with foreshadowing and callback. When the show begins, we're greeted by a frog playing the piano. We are then treated to a montage, which we realize at least by its reprise at the end of the series that this was an introduction to each of the show's chapters. The song and montage establish from the outset that we will be in a dreamlike world with a variety of different characters, some of whom, like this frog, will sing songs. In the following episodes, the primary melody from this song is transformed into a prelude, an example of incidental music. This prelude becomes part of a consistent unifying presence at the beginning of each episode. The prelude begins, the opening title card is displayed, one of the images from the frame is removed to be placed alongside the chapter title, the prelude fades out, and a beat of silence prepares us for a visual and musical introduction to the part of this world we are occupying for the next 11 minutes. Oh hey, we're wandering along the countryside. Oh my, we're in a fancy mansion with John Cleese. Oh hey, we're in the video essay that I'm still filming. So meta. Consistent tempo in the opening moments of each installment is a tried and true device in episodic television. But the changing title cards in Over the Garden Wall clue us in that these episodes are not solely meant to stand on their own. They're each part of a tightly knit story, one woven together in part by the show's songs. While the show's diegetic music comes from a wide variety of genres, it doesn't outright rely on the incidental music to bring it together because it has unifying elements of its own. For the most part, the songs sung by the characters in the show are harmonically simple, using primarily, if not only, 1 chords, 4 chords, and 5 chords, and they come in simple forms, like strophic form, binary form, rounded binary form, and ternary form, usually grouped into 4 lines of 4 measures each. This approach to harmony and form is common practice in many early European American folk traditions, but it's important to note that variations to these forms are not uncommon either. But let's put a pin in that. Foreshadowing. As we track Wirtz and Greg's transformation from naivete to maturite, the songs track this story by commenting on the narrative, mood, and themes of the story in a structure similar to the song cycle. And with that, we're gonna have to talk about some dead German guys.
Time to talk about dead German guys!
Song cycles are groups of individually complete songs that are written to be performed in a sequence. While the song cycle structure has since found its way into musical theater and arguably into commercial music, it primarily grew out of the German Romantic tradition, where songs are called Lieder. Lieder were typically songs written for solo voice with piano accompaniment, and were settings of German poetry centered on romantic love, pastoral themes, or the cycle of life. And hopefully it's clear why that ties in with Over the Garden Wall, because I'm going on a lot of tangents today. While there's some argument about the definition of song cycle, and as a result what the first song cycle actually is, generally that title is awarded to this guy named Ludwig von Beethoven, who wrote An die Ferne geliebt. Song cycles were further popularized by later German Romantic composers, most notably by Schumann and Schubert. And to clarify, there's actually 2 Schumanns. There's the Schumann that never wrote a bad song, and there's the Schumann who wrote a couple of clunkers, but who also wrote an absolute masterpiece of the song cycle genre called Dichterliebe in 1840. Franz Schubert also wrote some fantastic song cycles, and arguably his best is his setting of Die Schönemüllerin in 1823. But we'll get to that.
Foreshadowing.
Song cycles, as opposed to other forms of theatrical performance, aren't expected to follow traditional storytelling structures. One should not expect to see beat-by-beat storytelling in a song cycle the way that they might in opera or musical theater. In typical song cycle structure, each song serves to enlighten the audience about the mental state of the protagonist, the world in which they inhabit, or the symbols which serve to heighten the central theme of the cycle. In other words, song cycles tell stories through long-form and episodic story structures, just like Over the Garden Wall. Boom! Segway! The music in Over the Garden Wall mirrors the conventions of Lieder in a number of ways. Just like the masterworks of the song cycle genre, the songs in the show are typically performed by one singer with piano accompaniment. They're written in simple forms, like strophic or binary form. They highlight key elements of the narrative, and they serve to assign musical motives to characters and symbols in the story that can be recalled throughout the work. Perhaps the clearest example of this is the Beast song, Come Wayward Souls, which actually sounds a bit like a German lead, and is sung by operatic bass baritone Sam Raimi.
Come wayward souls and wander through the darkness. There is a light for the lost and the meek. Sorrow and fear.
This song comes to represent the loss of hope and the Beast's evil intentions to turn children into Edelwood trees. With that in mind, the decision to have children sing the B section of this song is super creepy. Greg's lead, Potatoes and Molasses, though it's a rag rather than a lead, comes to highlight his eccentric nature and his penchant for optimism even in the bleakest of circumstances. The song One as a Bird represents the love of family, specifically Beatrice and her family. While the song is only sung in the 10th and final episode, careful listeners might hear the song in the incidental music whenever Beatrice talks about her dedication to saving her family. And then to round out the main characters, there's Wirt's song.
Can you all give me some directions today so we can be on our way?
But it's not really a song. It's more just awkward Sprechstimme about his immediate desire to leave. Heck, even minor characters like Ms. Langtree or the occupants of the tavern have their own songs, so what gives? Well, while Greg is happy to play along with the odd events of the unknown, Wirt is quite aware that he doesn't belong there.
Folks don't tend to pass through Pottsfield.
Oh.
As a result, Wirt doesn't join in the antics of spontaneously breaking out into song. But beyond that more human motivation, there's a narrative decision at work here, too. The sporadic songs throughout the show do not only represent the characters who sing them, but they also represent Wirt's journey. While the minor characters represent isolated conflicts with clear themes and solutions, Wirt experiences all of it. Optimism and pessimism, love and heartbreak, timidness and bravery. And as a result, he doesn't have no songs. He has all of the songs. While Wirt's terrible singing in the tavern might imply on a first viewing that he exists outside of the song cycle narrative, the truth of the matter is, he is the song cycle narrative. And while we come to discover that he is a high schooler in a more or less modern setting, he actually turns out to have a lot in common with the protagonists of German Lieder. Let's go back to Dschirna Müllerin for a second.
Time to talk about it.
Alright, yeah, let's not milk it. In Franz Schubert's Dschirna Müllerin, we follow the story of a young miller who wanders along a brook until he finds a mill. In Over the Garden Wall, we track the story of a young high schooler and his brother as they wander along the forest until they find a mill by the brook. In Dschirna Müllerin, the young miller starts working for the miller of this mill and falls in love with the miller's daughter. But when his affections are bested by a hunter clad in green, he recites poetry, fantasizes about his death, and presumably drowns himself in the brook. In Over the Garden Wall, Wirt falls in love with a classmate, but when he believes that his affections have been bested by a boy clad in green, he recites poetry, fantasizes about his own death, and almost drowns in a brook. The story of Dschirna Müllerin is not traced beat by beat, but rather the songs highlight specific moments in the story. These songs could highlight interactions, such as the beginning of the journey, the discovery of the mill, the meeting of the miller girl, the protagonist's discovery that the miller girl has fallen for the hunter, or the fantasy of drowning in the brook. Or they can elaborate upon themes, motifs, and symbols in the story, such as the miller's relationship to the brook, the miller's obsession over the color green, or the symbolic relationship between flowers and love. Throughout Schubert's setting of Die Schönemüllerin, specific musical themes come to represent these characters or ideas that are repeated throughout the story. This could include the broken first inversion chord representing the brook, the horn call motive representing the hunter, or diminished chords and uncommon modulations representing uncertainty. The songs from Over the Garden Wall, while not sung by our protagonist, still use characters and themes as a reflection of the protagonist's journey. Each of the silly one-dimensional characters, and even the more fleshed-out recurring characters, serve to enhance the story of Wirt's journey through the unknown. And the music gives us some major clues. Ms. Langtry's Lament, the song which humorously depicts her ultimately misplaced feelings about her love interest, foreshadow Wirt's misinterpretation of Sarah's feelings for him versus Jason Funderburger. The overly simplistic musical musings of the Tavern Dwellers play a foil towards developing self-actualization. Through his interactions with these satirical, heavily labeled characters, he learns to grapple with his uncertainty and also recognize the complex emotions and desires of the people around him. The return of potatoes and molasses as putatus et molassus during the final episode serves multiple purposes. The translation in Latin is a reminder of death and the spiritual. The change in musical character represents Greg's transformation from kiddishly self-indulgent to altruistic and self-sacrificing. And, in a moment of action, it emphasizes Wirt's reaching for hope, echoing Greg's optimism rather than his previously characteristic pessimism. When One is a Bird is finally sung by Beatrice's mother, after only being hinted at through incidental music, it comes to represent not only Beatrice fulfilling her duty to her family, but also Wirt fulfilling his duty to Greg by waking up and saving both his brother and himself. And if that's not satisfying enough of a song cycle narrative for Wirt, well, he does subtly get his own song, but rather than singing it, he plays the bassoon, while the frog, who has been established as something of a narrator since the beginning of the show, sings for him. A single soul sets his voice singing, content to be slightly forlorn, is reminiscent of Wirt's poetic musings in the first episode.
Is the dove never to meet the sea for want of the odious mountain?
Two voices, now they are singing, then ten as the melody soars, seems to reference Wirt's participation in the redemption stories of the show's minor characters. And finally, then softly it falls by a house near a stream and over the garden wall to thee, foreshadows a flashback, where Wirt and Greg jump over the garden wall of the graveyard, and when they awaken in the unknown, they stumble upon a house near a stream to meet the woodsman at his mill. Most of the show's diegetic music is formally and harmonically about as simple as possible. The show's titular song, however, takes a different approach. Rather than sticking to the usual 1, 4, and 5 chords, the main song from Lullaby and Frogland uses most of the diatonic chords from its home key of G, as well as secondary dominants tonicizing E minor and B minor, and it even uses a flat 6 chord tonicizing A minor. This isn't something that a casual viewer would be expected to notice, but increased harmonic complexity tends to subconsciously alert the audience to deeper meaning. So when this song and the similarly complex Into the Unknown are sung by our frog narrator, Patrick McHale and the Blasting Company are cluing us into the central themes of the show. It's not about courtship or two-time and man or weird culinary concoctions. It's about coming of age, self-actualization, and the realization that no matter how much grief or trauma we may go through in our lifetimes, we should never completely let go of our childlike sense of optimism and imagination.
I guess the world really is as sweet as potatoes and molasses.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching. This video took a little bit longer than I was expecting, but I just really love this show and I feel like there's always more to dig into with it. That said, I know I left some stuff out. I know that you know that. If there's stuff you wish I would have talked about, please leave a comment in the comment section down below and we can just keep nerding out about this awesome show. Otherwise, if you did enjoy the video, please consider leaving it a like. It really does help me out. And also, please subscribe and hit the bell notification icon so that you get notified when my videos go live. If you'd like to support the channel, you can check out my Patreon and my Teespring. The links are in the description. I'm going to start doing some blooper reels and leaving video scripts for my supporters over on Patreon. And on Teespring, I have some new merch, including this shirt from the last video. But otherwise, just thank you guys so much. I've really appreciated the support, and I love y'all. And that's a rock fact.
Oh my, we're in a fancy mansion with John Cleese! Oh my, we're in a fancy mansion with John Cleese! Oh my, we're in a fancy mansion with John Cleese!
No, that wasn't very good.
Oh, my, we're in a fancy mansion with John Cleese.